Chairman.
Hey.
We've been talking a lot through digital tools, but now you're finally here.
And I think we met each other 8-10 times virtually, and but nothing replaces a real meeting. So it's great to be here.
Today we're going to discuss more around sustainability and in particular climate positivity and circularity. And I think those are topics that are close to the heart for both of us. Am I right?
Indeed. Yeah. And I think we share the same heritage and culture, but also the same interest in truly being part of taking the lead in this area together.
At least one key for us has been, well, obviously to set a goal, you know, 2040 climate positivity. But I don't know if you experience the same, because when it's so far away, we have to set sub goals to make it more actionable.
I agree with you. We need to have the long term vision, but it would be very dangerous to only aim for 40 or 50, because then we will be thinking and planning, but not acting. Yeah.
The mindset that we have is not really only transactions. It's about building relationships. And then looking at especially the young generation with the creativity that comes with that and a potential customer journey where a customer, of course, sometimes buy new things. And then what we should offer is sustainable products, but also adding other kind of things on that customer journey that would fulfill their demands. Mm. For example, resell or subscriptions or rentals. Mm. What's kind of your reflections on the future business model of IKEA?
Well, you can say, I'm super interested in learning from you. I think, first of all, I think it's interesting to see how fast consumers' mindset have changed the last years only. It's definitely not a linear progression, it's exponential. So we know, we do these researches typically once per year, and we ask some 30,000 plus people in 30 markets what they think about important things. And interesting enough, more than 70% of our customers are deeply concerned about climate change. Then comes a super scary fact, and that is only 6% see solutions or see themselves part of the solution. So there is a deep frustration on seeing that the problem is gigantic, but nobody's doing anything about it, which is, of course, also not true. I think, you know, the relationship we need to build is to build trust that we do our part.
I mean, to some extent, we also have similarities with our business ideas. So if I think of H&M Group and kind of the sweet spot of combining then fashion with quality and also price to be able to be there for many, and sustainability and making it, you know, a sustainable lifestyle accessible for the many, which is also why we truly think that we also with our size should be in the lead when it comes to sustainability.
Well, you know, on one hand, I sometimes feel that almost like the myths out there are among the biggest challenges. And I love what H&M is doing. I love what Unilever is doing. And a couple of the leaders, true leaders in this space, is like so firm on saying, no, a good product and good quality product shouldn't have to cost a lot. And a sustainable product shouldn't have to cost a lot. It's the opposite. So I think the most important thing that we together can do with the likes of Unilever and other companies is to change the narrative and bust the myth that sustainability should be expensive.
Yeah.
So I think back to you, also in H&M, how can we work together on maybe looking at some of these thresholds and see if we can bundle volume or at least bundle our influence together with other companies so we can make sure that incentives are put in the right place so we get there sooner.
Yeah, I think that type of collaboration has truly been a key when it comes to sustainable and recycled materials. I mean, we have been collaborating on a few initiatives to get that to scale, and also collaboration together with entrepreneurs and innovators that now we can start to take to scale. And of course, there's a lot more to do to change the whole industry, but I'm also thinking that I'm inspired by that type of collaboration, because now looking at one of our biggest challenges is linked to supply chain, since most of our products are produced in countries where energy is still kind of based on fossil fuels. And then I truly think that that type of collaboration, even though we're big, we know we can't solve it ourselves. So that type of collaboration and innovation is really important to speed up for us to be able to tackle that. It's such an essential part. And I also think about other ways to engage with customers. Here I feel such a big responsibility. Since, I mean, we are, as well as you, that window out to the customers and millions of customers around the globe that we meet every day. And then making those kind of sustainable choices or engaged through perfect fit denims, through AI tools or whatever it can be. But to engage with customers in that way, raise awareness and also make it easier for them to make those choices feels like such a big responsibility. But then we also have governments, right?
Absolutely.
And their responsibility also to you know, create those frameworks to level the playing field. So it's really about coming together around a common problem and like look at before. The different roles.
But you're right. I think us sitting here, I mean, there's always been, I think H&M and IKEA people have run into each other on airports and factories and all over, and always been, I think, energized by the similarities of our culture and whatnot. And now we have a different reason to be together, because I think all of us understand the challenges are bigger than our own impact. So we need to be together, which is incredibly exciting. And then you have, I think, the next breakthrough has to happen between corporations and governments. What I like is that we're slowly and gradually getting away from the formalities or the convincing each other about the problem, but more and more getting down to the nuts and bolts about how we actually engineer the future.
Since we're both founding members of Race to Zero Retail Alliance, what would you say that is kind of the expected outcome from that initiative?
If you're big, you have to step in and take your responsibility. And I see too few of the companies. We have Kingfisher, we have Walmart, but we also have a lot of big brands who have not yet taken the step to join that. So I think the best we can probably do is to rally rally more to that coalition.
Let's do that together. I think it's really important for more companies to come on board. And also, I mean, being humble of the crisis that we're in, and I guess you feel the same, that we don't have all the answers, obviously. But sometimes I also think that putting bold goals or getting out there without having all the answers is really what is necessary for us to create that type of movement. And sometimes I get the question, like, what's your advice for companies that haven't really started yet? And at least what I see is, and that has helped us, is to align with science. I mean, scientists have, they have told us the facts for so many years.
So it is.
So aligning kind of the ambitions and goals with science, I think, has helped us a lot. And then, of course, secondly, to know your value chain, you know, to get more knowledge when it comes to where in the value chain you have the biggest climate impact. And then thirdly, I'm thinking about integrating sustainability in the company so that, I mean, that comes with awareness from all colleagues, but also creates the accountability that this is about business. You know, it's about long-term profitable growth and together with taking responsibility, of course.
A lot of people talk from, we need to consume less, which we might want to agree to, but that's not going to be the solution.
No,
the solution sits in how do we make the core of human consumption basic needs, sustainable at the core, by being renewable, circular, or the equation of it. And I think it could be interesting maybe for us to look at that. What is the rule book of communicating progress?
Right.
In a way so we can get out of this greenwashing fear and talk about the real things, including the scrutiny that we, of course, all of us involve. So these would be two things I would love to explore together with you.
Sounds amazing. I'm also thinking there is something with marrying creativity with sustainability that I think we also have in common. And here I'm really excited to see, I think this has been highlighted even more after the pandemic when, I mean, people want to dress up again, they want to express themselves, they are finally meeting, you know, friends and family again. So marrying these two, I think, is such an important topic for both of us to attract even more customers and kind of continue that movement.
We would love to continue to, together with you, explore if we can find, use creativity as a driver for this as well.
Cool. Yeah. So nice to meet you, Jesper.
Fantastic. Looking forward to collaborate with you and learn from you as we take this to the next step.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.